I'm so guarded these days. I'm like, what can I say? What can't I say? I can't fucking say anything anymore.
She's suffering enough living with that man.
That's the fucking Faustian bargain right there. Oh, Jesus, man. Christ.
This is a town of Faustian bargains.
It is.
That's what we do here in LA.
I think it is. I know. I'm starting to wonder. I'm really like, look, am I? What happened?
Well, I, looking at you, knowing that everything starts, every sentence about you starts at this point with North Irish actress. anything anybody writes about you, that's all they start. And yet, most of your career, certainly on film and television, has been here.
That's right.
How did that happen?
It's a trick. I played a cunning plan on my
part.
You're
really Spanish or?
Cuban.
Cuban, there you go.
It's just the way it was. I think that I left Northern Ireland at a certain time in my life. I left when I was 19 or younger. And I moved to New York and sort of became really integrated into that. I also didn't want, I'd grown up in Belfast, I didn't want the whole conversation of like, are you Irish? Well, who are you for? Are you pro-IRA? Right. Are you anti? And I was still trying to come to terms, until I was about 40, come to terms with that cultural identity. Mm-hmm. And so in a weird way, it sort of just happened that I played Americans easily.
Did you go to New York just to go to New York and get
just
out?
To go to
or
New York
were you
to
wanting
get
to act?
No, I didn't want to act. I still don't.
It's just come
all,
upon you?
I don't know what happened. I do want to act, but I didn't particularly. It wasn't a particular thing. I didn't really grow up in a very aspirational kind of environment that you got to choose. So it did come to me in that way, sort of did come upon me, and I sort of ran with it, I suppose, you know.
What was the first thing you did?
I did a thing called Another Girl, Another Planet, based on the song. Well, it wasn't the title of the song by The Only Ones.
Right.
Because it's a great title.
Yes.
And it was shot on a Pixel Vision camera.
Wow.
By a guy called Michael Almereda. And I played the bartender, because I was a bartender. And he saw me in a bar and he said, will you be in my movie? And I was like, oh, Jesus, okay. And then my next thing was a bigger project called Tombstone.
It's a lot bigger project.
Fight at the OK Corral.
Yes, and multiple directors.
Multiple directors.
You had that experience right off the bat.
I did. So I had the betrayal, the schadenfreude, everything that, you know, Hollywood is meant to be was encapsulated in that one experience.
And was that like a, did you take to acting like a fish to water? Or
kind
did you?
Of. Well, I didn't really think it was career that you could have. I mean, I don't know that I thought about it. I just found myself in, I was sort of cast out of the blue by Kevin Jarre, who was the first director, and Kevin had sort of handpicked all these actors. Some were doing better than others at the time.
Right.
And so it's all this sort of strange group of people that he collected. And
did you consider yourself an actor when you got that gig?
No. I didn't even know what a mark was back then. You know, Sam Elliott played my husband, and I think we had this first day, this big crane shot, and I have a line, and I'm like, oh, fuck. And he just would nip me on the bum every time I had to speak.
That sounds like Sam.
He could feel the camera, and I didn't have the savvy to do that at the time. And then it just seemed like, oh, yeah, I could probably do this.
Sam is one of my favorite regulars on the show.
Is he?
Whenever there's a chance for Sam and I hang out. Because he's just
I love Sam, and I haven't seen Sam in years. And he was my first TV, or not movie, husband.
He did a sitcom this last year,
Jesus.
The last couple of years on Netflix.
That's right. What's that called?
It's called The Something. What's it called? The Something. It's with him, Deborah Winger.
Yes.
Yeah,
why
it's great cast.
Why have I not seen it?
Because it's Netflix and it's hard to find things.
It's really hard to find things.
You get lost on Netflix.
Well, it's just after 8 o'clock I fall asleep anyway.
There you
go. I'm full of great intentions at 7 after Jeopardy. I'm like, right, what am I going to watch tonight? And then it just all goes downhill.
Yeah, my wife tried to watch The Americans last night for, I think, 5 straight hours. And she kept on, every time I'd walk in the bedroom, they would be starting again, you know. And then it kind of ran on, and she woke up at some point, and it ruined it, like the next two episodes for her.
Was she watching the final season?
She's in the final season, but she was like five episodes back.
Oh, Jesus.
So then it was ahead a couple episodes, and there was a spoiler that she didn't really want to know, but she'd fallen asleep and woke up right into the spoiler. So it's very complicated, falling asleep early.
I can't. And then I hear it, and I don't know what's happening, and yeah, so.
It's all been ruined
I managed to get through Barry quite quickly, because that was sort of...
It's half hours at least.
Half hour.
Yeah. Makes a big difference.
That's where I'm at.
You can get through the half hour. The hours, you're working your way up to it.
Exactly.
So have you ever watched Ray Donovan? Have you ever seen the show?
A couple times in ADR.
Really? So you don't watch yourself?
I do watch it. I mean, I haven't watched them all. I would watch it to see, so that I could complain, like, why are you shooting me like that? Why do I look so fucking awful? You know, but
are you ever satisfied by what you look like on camera?
I like Deadwood.
Mm.
We shot on film.
Yeah,
that's when it all went downhill after the, you know, with digital. I don't know.
Huh.
Once in a while, I'm like, that's nice. That's okay.
Are you picky about yourself? Or are you like
not in real life? I'm not picky in real life. I just think sort of on. I think on screen, there's something about. I think playing that character, she was quite antagonistic at the beginning. You know, she was always at him, like nipping at his neck, you know. And I would say, could you shoot me more favorably so I don't look like such a shrew? Mm-hmm. You know, because there's something about like the language, the accent, the, you know, my hair. The creator of the show insisted that my hair stay very red, even though I'm not a redhead. So it was all these things, and I was like, oh, you know, I'd get like comments like, you know, she's too, why would Ray be attracted to this woman, all this sort of thing. And so felt bad about that for a while, but I kind of got over it.
So season 3 or 4, when you kind of learned why they loved each other.
Yes. Yeah, or season 5, maybe.
Season 5, maybe.
When she's dead.
Was it that long? Well, it didn't take until you were completely dead.
I always knew why she loved him.
Right.
You know.
But you weren't always sure why she would put up with it.
I guess maybe that was what people, you know, people were compelled to sort of ask those questions of why are they together.
But
when
I think
when
really...
When he's like shagging other women and, you know...
You felt like he really wanted to come home.
Of course he did.
I mean, it wasn't like he would be off doing all these start with other things, but when he came
He had to come home.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, he had to. I mean, otherwise, what would he have been? Just a caricature.
We're still finding that out. We have more seasons to go.
I know. In New York.
In New York. But you don't have to move. Do you live in Los Angeles? Or
I live here and not there in New York.
So you don't have to move back to New York.
I'm not going. I'm done. I'm dead.
I'm done. I said, if you're going back to New York, you got to kill me.
Well, they said if we're going to New York, we have to kill you.
Oh. It's funny how that works.
Yeah.
I know very few actors to give up a series because they wanted to. A few.
No.
Mandy Patinkin.
Mandy Patinkin, David Caruso.
David Caruso, though he went back.
But he sort of did or didn't. I think Milch's version is, he said, can I do 8? And Milch said, how about you do none? Something like that.
Yeah.
I don't think, I mean, that'd be
tough
hard.
Story.
It'd be hard to give up a series because you're getting paid.
Yeah.
You know, if that's like saying, you know, I'm just going to gamble on, also you've built something. For me, I think it was a good time to leave.
Mm-hmm.
For me, I don't think necessarily for the show, but I think for me, I sort of feel like there are other stories that I want to tell, you know?
Mm-hmm. I feel like they wrote your best season for you, for your character.
Died. That's what sucks about it. It's like everybody's like, that's your best season. I'm like, fuck. Cancer? Really?
But you had more... But no, I mean after being dead, even.
Really?
I think you dead was... I think you had more airtime dead than you did alive. I felt like...
I don't know.
You had a lot of airtime dead.
Dead?
Yeah.
I suppose dead in the flashbacks.
Yeah.
I
there was a lot of it.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, no, God, yes, absolutely.
But I felt like they actually gave you more airtime.
Right.
And you were like the dominant character that season.
Yeah, I think they kept trying to make that a B storyline and it just wanted to pull focus.
Yeah, I kept on waiting for Susan Sarandon to actually have a part and
yes,
never happened.
No.
Because you kept on winning.
Yes.
Taking the day.
Right. Well, that's what happens when you've been there. You know?
They want to say goodbye properly.
Yeah. There was that. I think there was that sort of aspect of doing it. I don't know, sometimes that's the thing when you're doing TV like that, you don't know where it's going to go. So they had, yeah. I know they had other ideas about how the season would have sort of, you know, they pretty much got about four episodes figured out by the time we get in there and sort right. of, but it tends to go the way it's going to go energetically.
So do you know four in when you're shooting something, or are you on the same
not
script?
Not really. I mean, you sort of know, you know, bits and pieces. Sometimes you know nothing. Mm. I don't like to know too much. I sort of like, I mean, that's kind of why I love television, is mm-hmm. I don't want to have a course set. So all sorts of urges and whims and notions and kind of things can come into that, can come into play. And if you're in a good enough and, you know, collaborative enough environment, that's all working together, you know. So and I learned that from Milch.
Well, this and Deadwood are really the two long yeah. running experiences.
Right.
So was that experience as fulfilling in some ways as this experience? As the...
As
Donovan?
Was Deadwood? Yeah, it yeah. was. Yeah. Because I think I feel like that show really kind of made me sort of sit up and pay attention and learn television, learn TV from a really one of the best, you know, and that sort of, that way of kind of following a writer and leading a writer and having to be incredibly, I mean, the way I like to work is just be incredibly open to the process and give as much as, like, sort of, like, really crack yourself open to the process, you know, and that gets hard sometimes because a lot of actors block out of fear, you know, so just resisting those urges. And
right.
I got to trust David Milch because he was so brilliant that was the only and most prudent way to go, was to trust him completely.
Because you really had no choice.
It just wouldn't have been what it was without that. And everybody did.
Yeah.
You know, we didn't have one person on that show who ever said, wouldn't do this.
Mm.
You know, because there was one defining auteur.
Right.
You know, we didn't have six people quibbling over it. It was just Dave and then us sort of giving him our best, you know.
And is having the crew of actors around you for a number of years, is that a special experience? Is it a different experience? Are you ready to take a vacation at the end of it? Or
yeah, I think that's because you sort of know them like siblings at that point. So, I mean, I miss them terribly. I'm also glad to be rid of them. But I really miss them, you know?
And do you miss having that character, or you were ready? It sounds like you were ready to go find some other characters.
I miss that she sort of was the, she's kind of like in her own weird way, sort of in charge of the family.
Mm-hmm.
And I miss that. I miss that sort of coming to work and knowing what my job was. You know, really, really knowing my place in that world. I think that's very satisfying. And then getting to dig into that.
Is there any downside to it?
No. Not really. I mean, you just take on a lot of baggage, a lot of everybody else's stuff. Because it's sort of, you know, you're the mummy to everybody.
Mm.
But no, it's a good feeling for me. It was very, you know, satisfying for me.
Is that your natural role?
Yeah.
Everybody's mom.
Yeah. And I think
sister.
Like and worrying about people, and even though they don't want me to. I was told recently to not give unsolicited advice. And I was like, well, what use am I gonna be to anybody? How can I love you?
Does anybody solicit advice anymore?
I don't think so. I know. I was like, do I have to wait for may I? You know, may I offer a suggestion? No. Oh fuck, okay.
But I was just thinking, just in case,
just
maybe.
So I have to, I'm trying to stop those urges, but I don't know.
So can you fix the entire world, or just are you focused on specific people? One dog at a time, that's
yeah.
your, okay.
Yeah.
Did you ever have the God thing? Had you ever wanted to be God and control everything? And
no.
Have the answers to all things?
No, I do not want to be that. just my own little corner.
Yeah.
You know?
I was thinking about that recently because I thought, like, I think when I was like 14 or something, I thought I should be in charge.
A deity of some sort
of deity. Like, if I were in charge, the world would make sense.
I could totally see that.
But I was so wrong. I didn't, I like, you know, I've
Let
learned
other people
to.
Screw it up.
Well, just that it's not, yeah. No, well, nobody's that wise, but also you can't play that many fields at the same time.
Can't
well,
play all those fields. That's it.
It's not that interesting.
I think for me, I feel like people are so loath to offer really signed and to really help, you know. It's this idea of wait to be asked.
Right.
But who's gonna really ask? What's wrong with offering and jumping in, you know, with all yourself?
Well, people are afraid to ask, I think.
I think they are, and that's, yeah. But isn't that thing, is like they have to come, they have to ask otherwise, and you're like, no.
Well, there's a degree to which it can be, you know.
I guess.
I mean, we have an 8-year-old, so we have a school full of people who all need help.
Yes.
And I try to explain to my wife that she's actually not in charge of this one or that one, and doesn't have to tell them how to fix their child's life or take responsibility for the pain they're going through when they're 8 years old or 10 years old or whatever it is. And it's like, you know.
Oh,
but
God.
She'll get over it.
Yeah, I know. I don't know. I just think it's nice to sort of go like, I have a great idea. What do you think about this? You know?
Well, that's why you have friends. That's why people have relationships, is that they can get unsolicited advice.
Yeah.
So going back
a
few years, when did you, so you did Tombstone.
Yes.
Was there a point then or shortly after where you felt like, okay, now I'm really getting this, now I know what I'm doing?
No, I didn't. I would, so I came to live in LA because I felt like New York was too small for me.
Well, if you don't want to be a stage actress, it's pretty limited.
I didn't mind doing stage.
Yeah. But I mean, if that's not your career aspiration.
But I wasn't like pulled geographically because of career. I just, there was something about heading west that seemed, I was reading Sam Shepard and, you know, I wanted to like be in the wide open spaces or whatever. I like the idea of driving a car and nobody, I don't know, there was just something, I was very self-conscious and I liked the idea of being kind of, having more privacy, not running into things all the time, do you know?
I left New
Which
York
we crave
for much that reason.
Yeah, but we crave that when we live in LA. We're like, why are we all stuck in our cars? But
I see way too many people I know every day.
Everywhere.
Yeah.
It's too much.
Yeah.
So
that's why I left New York myself. And I left Chicago for that same reason.
Because New York is like, you know, I was below 14th Street for the most part. I'd get on my bike and, you know, go across the bridge or something, but you know, mostly that was my turf, along with a bunch of other Irish immigrants in the 90s, you know?
Mm-hmm. The good old days.
The good old days. But, so I came for that, and then I was just kind of trying to be an actor, I suppose.
Mm.
Doing plays, doing commercials, getting a job here and there on TV. Getting a movie once in a while.
And hanging out otherwise? Was it just kind of like, were you laid back about it? Or were you like anxious to make something happen?
People tell me that I worked really, really hard and went through some, you know, dark times. And I'm like, did I? I think I did. I mean, I know that there were times when I felt like going home to Ireland. But there was nothing there for me. I mean, there was my family, which is incredibly significant to me. But I wouldn't have had my own thing, and I suppose there was part of me that didn't want to go back without something in my pocket that was of weight and note, and it's also probably one of the reasons I didn't start working in Ireland until later as well. Like, I wanted to go back fully, like I have this shit down completely, and I know what I'm doing, and now you have to pay me for my services.
I've earned my place.
Yeah. So there's something about that, and maybe slightly a little bit of revenge for being told, like, you know, getting kicked out of school at 15 or whatever, you know.
So why were you kicked out of school? Dare I ask why you were kicked out of school at 15?
Probably just being, like, mad ADD or something, or, like, you know, say, I mean, I think there was, like, there was one report in school it said she persists in making animal noises in class despite being snorting or something, and then singing. I was always singing in the hallways.
Hmm. Were you pissed off or just exuberant?
It was more like a chance. Like it was some way to get through the like monotony of it. The terrible, you know, crushing monotony for me of going to that kind, you know, a kind of school that there was no place for creativity.
Huh. It's interesting. We're trying to break our 8-year-old of singing out loud all the time and everything. But I mean, I kind of like it.
But I was like outrageous. Like people knew me for that because I just like belt songs. And it wasn't like I was trying to be like, look at me, I'm so... It wasn't like that. It was just for me. You know?
Yeah. You were in your own space.
I was in my own space.
Did you have other kids who came along for that ride? Or
sometimes I think some people did. I think they thought, you know, they tell me now, oh, you were an extraordinary person. And I think they didn't think that at all at the time. It's only because I'm on TV now.
Well, they said you were a weird person. Would that seem more real to you? Or?
I think that might seem more real.
A little less positive.
Perhaps, yes.
Do you take compliments well in general?
Terribly.
Huh. Yeah. Always? That's always been a... Or do you think the person's being sarcastic, or you just...
I think it's an Irish thing.
Yeah.
You know... I'll say to my mom, you look beautiful. Oh my God. You know, it's that thing or, you know,
yeah,
you know, it's just, they just don't sit well with it. It's also not how we, you know, you don't live in that culture of girls are pretty and it's not really like that there.
No.
You know, it's like, I mean, I think America is a bit more princessy with that stuff, you know?
Unfortunately.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's a little weirder.
So that was kind of, that was always not, you know.
But I think families with a lot of kids, you know, being around and having space to be together, which you don't have as much certainly in the urban environment in America, creates that kind of, you know, evenness.
Yes.
Instead of that, oh, there's the pretty one. Oh, there's this one. Oh, there's
the labels and the, yes. And like, how do you, we're about to change any second as well, you know.
Yeah.
So let's not get stuck in that, you know. Those pretty girls, you know, those pretty babies. Oh, those terrible babies. The babies who are, like, horrendous. They're so beautiful when they're older.
It is weird. it is. That
isn't
is,
it?
Yeah.
I know.
You never know. It's really
never know.
It's a mystery. Well, it starts with the eye color. Like, you can't... The first 6 months, the eyes, you don't know what they're going to be.
You don't know what's going to happen.
Yeah, could go any direction.
Yeah.
I thought I was going to have some with... blue eyes for about 4 months and I was wrong.
It all turned the other way.
Well, we both have brown eyes, so there was like no way really it was going to happen. It would have been a miracle, like something. But it was like, it would have been really attractive.
I
people
know.
Like blue eyes.
Did you see Patrick Melrose yet?
I haven't been able to watch it. I haven't had a chance to watch it yet.
So the kid, who's very good,
is
playing Benedict Cumberbatch, is playing
the young
him
one.
When he, but he's brown eyes. I'm like... I mean, and it shouldn't matter because the performance is so good, but I'm like, this is not, I can't.
Yeah. No, I can understand that.
Yeah.
It makes sense to me. So when did you get to the point where you were like, okay, I'm an actor. I know what I'm doing. You're an idiot not to be hiring me.
I think I did a play. A Eugene O'Neill play, Anna Christie, and I was like, all right, you know, right, this is fucking, like, and, you know, doing it every night, and it's a big emotional, his plays are so big and overwrought, and operas, and I could do that consistently, you know, and had a chance to, and had these great big speeches and stuff, and I thought, oh, yeah, this feels like I feel the power of this, you know.
Was New York or here?
This was here, and then not long after that, I got Deadwood, and she was, you know, was playing a prostitute, and sort of, yeah, there was something about, I think around that time, I started to really feel this, was something that I tried to hold on to as being an actor, was that it's very easy to diminish yourself, because you're one of many trying. And so how do you make your life interesting? You know, what are you reading? Who are you looking at? Who are you talking to? What's going on in your life that's an artistic life versus this single focus of, I want to be an actor. And then you become a really, really boring fuck.
Right.
You know? So I think that was going on, and I was, you know, Deadwood, I was around very interesting people. All the people that Milch brought in for that show were cowboys and all sorts of, like, lunatics, you know, all kinds of people. And I loved that, you know, that was just filled up with all of these sort of odd, assorted sociopaths.
But it sounds like you hit the place where you were full and ready to...
I think David...
Like you were ready for it when it came.
I feel like... Yes, David always talks about... I talk about him a lot because he is such a... You know, without him, I don't know. But he talks about visions come to prepared souls.
Yeah.
You know? And I think he was able to see the quirks of me and... sort of mirror it back to me in ways that I didn't really understand of myself, you know. Mm-hmm. And that was sort of the great gift that he gave me as an actress, you know, that this is like, this is so valuable. Our first day of working together, you know, I think he picked up that I like language, you know, mm-hmm. that I'm Irish, that, you know, we have this way with language. And so he said something like, what's a good word for such and such, you know. And that's very empowering to somebody who's on a set with all sorts of, you know.
Yeah. The guy who's the wordsmith asking for a word.
He was asking for a word. And I don't think he did that because he needed a word.
Right.
You know, I think he did it as a kindness and also as a validation that I was valuable.
Mm. So you came out of that feeling self-possessed?
Yeah. I mean, as much as you can for, you know, as, I mean... For an actor, yeah, but I think that was a very affirming, also to be on a series where you can feel your effect, where you can feel that your moving story, you know, starts to feel really like, okay, I have a reason, I have a meaning, this is not just me, like, clocking in, and this, I have something to do here, you know, that's, so, yeah.
So when they asked you to, that when they suggested to you that you could be Jennifer Lawrence's mother, did you cry immediately, or? She seems awfully old to be your daughter.
Well, she was young. And it's the second time I played her mom, although I didn't know. She told me I played her mom on a TV show.
That's fine.
And we were separate. Our stories were separate.
Huh.
So you know, Jennifer sort of like, when she saw me, when we went in to rehearse and meet each other, she kind of leapt up and said, you've already, you know. And yeah, I didn't know anything about that whole sort of situation.
It was just a good gig to book?
It was a good gig, because it seemed like people wanted that job, but they just gave it to me, and then it was a really good gig to have. I didn't have anything to do in it, but I made money. I mean, I had nothing to do.
You get to go on the reunion tour every year or two.
You know.
I spent some time in Atlanta. Was they shot that in Atlanta or Vancouver?
North Carolina.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, that seemed like the ultimate, that whole series seemed like the kind of the ultimate, one of those things where you just kind of go off in the cash checks and it's fabulous. And
go off in cash
a
checks.
A lot of really interesting actors gather together, even though they don't have much to do.
Yeah. Me, I would sneeze and, you know, walk through a scene looking, you know, sort of forlorn and, you know, catatonic or whatever.
Big challenge.
Well, I read the books and I thought there's more to do, but they weren't going to focus on that aspect. Right. Nobody wanted to see 40-year-old something woman, you know. They wanted to see teenagers running about looking fit.
Oh, those kids.
Yeah.
Did you miss the fact that you were not a teenager trying to break into Hollywood, or are you happy that was not what
I
you root was?
So, I mean, for me, I just had a very different way of... I mean, I didn't own a pair of high heels till I was in my 30s. I didn't... I mean, I remember I went to meet Steven Spielberg wearing Birkenstocks. You know,
probably
and I'm sure he did because he hired me. And, you know, but I didn't... I just didn't have that kind of sophistication of, like, this is how to dress and this is how you're going to, like, go get a job, you know? All I knew how to do was be good at my job. So I didn't have all that pressure on me. You know, they'd say... if a role was described as sexy or attractive, I'd just show up in my jeans because I didn't have anything.
Right.
But I just didn't, I couldn't, that took me a long time to sort of, you know, and I'd do that in the work, you know, that's in the work, but I wasn't trying to be something you know.
So were you good in a room, do you think? In a rehearsal room or an audition room?
Depends on the room. Yeah, really depends on the room.
Because the people were giving to you or not giving it to you? Or?
I think it just depended on the way, if I could feel that my particular whatever I have was being received. If I felt like they were looking for something else or disinterested, I would be not very good. Maybe cheeky.
So you know who you want to work with when you meet them.
Yeah, and I used to be cheeky. I mean, I used to be cheeky. Like, I'd argue with directors in auditions. Like, why? You're not going to get the job.
Right.
But occasionally one might like it, you know?
Yeah. Or at least you get a dinner date out of it. Or
I think what it was that there was something about conflict that really kind of I come from. I grew up in Belfast. I come from this place of, like, that's how we create. So I thought it was okay, but it probably wasn't. But I've learned not to do that.
And you dress up for auditions now?
I don't audition.
There you go. That's right. You skipped over that part. Very smart of you. It's very clever.
Occasionally. I mean, I'm sure. Let's see. When was the last audition I had? Don't know.
So how did Ray Donovan come into your life?
I auditioned for it.
There you go.
But that was nearly seven years ago.
You were a small child.
A tiny dancer.
Barely out of elementary school.
So you didn't
make it out of elementary school, so it worked out nicely.
Exactly. I read it. I liked it. I liked the idea that I knew it was going to be Liev. I thought that might be interesting. His, you know, bigness and masculinity, and I just thought, and I liked her, the working classness of it. I like family stories.
And did the idea of going back to something that was a longer form piece ultimately?
Oh yeah, I mean, even in between that, I'd done everything I'd sort of done was a chunk.
Right.
You know, I did I think four or five people saw the show I did called Caprica. Which was Battlestar thing.
To say that I had to look it up to make sure it was from this country. I was thinking maybe it was an Irish show because I hadn't even heard of it.
Nobody heard of it. Or they heard of it, but they didn't like it. It wasn't right. Mm. It just wasn't right. But, you know, that... And that's not really my world either. Right. You know?
So being the alien princess is not your thing?
I think I could be a good alien princess.
Or maybe you could have been the captain. You could still be a captain on a starship.
But that's would have been, like, I think they put it all out there for Battlestar, but they sort of didn't know quite where we were going to go with that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, it's weird how popular Battlestar was in and of itself.
So popular.
And yet, they never quite figured out how to make it into Walking Dead or whatever. You know, never became that kind of popular.
It's interesting.
It's very culty somehow, but hugely popular.
Hugely popular, I remember. Yeah. But you don't hear people talking about it now the way they used to.
No.
You know?
I know some guys who talk about it
still.
Oh, I'm
sure. Creepy, I know those guys.
They come
stand like this close.
I love Caprica.
Yeah, they love Caprica. You know? But yeah.
Have you done comic? Did you do Comic-Con with that?
Never did any comedy.
No, Comic-Con.
Oh, Comic-Con, no.
No.
Nope.
Do you think you'd like that experience?
No.
Do you know much about it? Or?
I know that you go and there's a lot of people.
Yeah.
I think that's all I know.
They put you in a panel and they scream a lot.
Yeah. I don't know. I mean, I think the things that I could be happy to do those things if it was a project that I was very enthusiastic about. I'm always happy to talk about... gets a little trickier when you're on something where you're not quite as jazzed about it, you know?
Those are always interesting
interviews.
It's really
hard. Or you have to lie and cover for people and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And that's tough.
Yeah. That's... And
it's really tough.
Yeah.
It just stops all the flow.
Or something happened. That's always
or
like...
Something happened.
Some story.
I know. Yeah.
Yeah. I was supposed to shoot somebody who was, I think... Rachel Brosnahan. At some point we were talking about shooting something and her aunt just committed suicide.
Jesus.
And it's like, I don't know how she can do an interview. And then, I mean, obviously it's the Emmy season and there's all those pressures of that, but I can't imagine her going out and talking to anybody at this point because everybody's going to ask the question and who wants to answer that question?
God.
You know, it's terrible.
They don't give a fuck. It's like...
No, they don't.
And also I think the thing about being an actor, you always think, I gotta go do my thing. This is my job. It's like, no, I mean, I was sort of lucky in that a lot of the press responsibilities on something like Caprica, they kind of put that, because Eric and I were very reluctant to kind of get any attention.
Mm-hmm.
We're very similar, like we just don't want it. So they kind of put it on Alessandra, who played my daughter on that, mm-hmm. and she really liked it and enjoyed it. You know, she's really good at it. So we were delighted, and then, you know, a lot of the time I'm always quite pleased when someone else has to do that. Unfortunately, these days, we can't really avoid it because it's all about,
well, that's what they think right now, at least.
I don't know what's happened.
Yeah.
Something's happened.
No, it's definitely changed. My theory is that it's going to change again pretty soon.
Go back to being, like, obscure.
I think that there's going to be, like, a restraint thing. I think there are two things that will happen, is that the distance out from which people are now promoting everything will be much shorter.
Right.
And that the idea of something, you don't have to get it 8 months out, but you do have to get it right.
Yeah.
And I think sometimes they rush things out because they all feel like they have to go these long lead things now, and they get it wrong.
It's so rushed, and it's all wrong.
Yeah.
I mean, I can't tell you how few things I know what the hell I'm doing before I do them.
And then withholding, I think, will become a fad pretty soon. But, like, it's funny because Liev, who is not exactly a camera-loving guy, an internet or whatever, a journalism-loving, but I saw him in Germany for the new Wes Anderson movie. Goofy as hell. He was really funny.
He's really funny.
He seems so serious in everything he does. And yet,
it's good when he has that, because it's a side of him that people don't get to see very much, and it is really nice. Yeah.
Yeah. He was almost silly. It was like, oh,
yeah,
my.
He can be goofy.
Yeah. He was definitely in goofy German time. That was the.
Yeah.
I think he probably not have sleep was part of it, but
who knows what else?
All the guys, exactly. Anything that happened in Germany.
Yeah.
When you're in Berlin, anything.
Totally.
Anything's possible.
Yeah.
So do you have dreams and aspirations now that you've escaped television's grasp for a moment?
I'm looking for something to do that I can have some sovereignty over.
Well, I saw you just did the show back at home.
I did.
You did a series.
I did.
That looks like it was interesting and an interesting cast.
It was interesting. It was very well received. It was
and limited, which is nice.
Limited. I don't like limited.
Huh.
Because I want to go back and reshoot everything, you know, and go like, oh, now I know what I. I like that to be limited because it was very dark, it was bleak, it was a lonely job, and we were shooting in the winter in Belfast, and it was very fast. It was very different from shooting here,
mm-hmm.
And we just didn't have time and money, and so. But it was a good experience. It was great to work in Belfast, and it was a subject that I wanted to deal with. A woman leaving her kids. I wanted her to leave them forever, though. she goes back. But yeah, I'm looking for kind of a thing.
Something that's more like you, or something that's further away from you.
Ultimately, on television, I think that you end up making it like some parts of you. I think that's where you get those crossovers, and that's where the really good truth comes in. I'd like to do kind of I'd like to play a cop. And with all the tropes, you know, she drinks too much, she fucked her boss, she's
gonna play a bad cop.
Yeah, like okay. In the 70s. You know, she's got supernatural abilities, like she can fucking smell like a dog or something, you know?
She can smell like
the truth, yeah.
She can smell things like a dog, she doesn't smell like a dog.
Yeah, I'm thinking of that T.C. Boyle story where the guy, you know, there's a woman who goes out and she's like feral. She runs around all night. She doesn't do that. My cop doesn't do that.
But, I was just thinking she smells of dog would be a bad way to go with that.
Terrible. But yes. Maybe that's her thing.
That's right.
That's actually... Mm.
She attracts odd men who like the smell of dogs.
Yeah. Yeah, how does that work? But you know, I loved Happy Valley so much.
Mm-hmm.
I love that, and you know, I love that working class kind of backdrop for these, you know, real lives, real people, you know.
So you want to go edgier?
Even edgier, yes. Yes, edgier.
And are there, or do you have, like, I want to work with this one, or I want to, I mean, obviously, if Milch came
I'd
back.
I'd like to, well, we're doing Deadwood, so I will get to do.
Oh, yeah, you're doing a
we're
movie?
We're going to do a movie.
Yeah, that's exciting.
It is. It is. I quite like to work with Ethan Hawke. I quite like to do something with him.
That's his...
Because I just think he's growing so much as an artist, and he's interesting, and every time I see him talking about stuff, I really like what the way he approaches the work, and he's in it for the real, seems to me, like, real reasons.
Well, he's actually, as a feature coming out, that the performances are really quite amazing.
Yeah, he just gets better.
Yeah. Well, you know? He directed this one.
Oh, he directed it? Yeah. Good for him.
And it's about a musician. It's a real life story, actually. And he got these great performances out of non-actors, and he has some regular actors, and he's mixed it up. And, it's really effective.
I just like that sort of, you know, the thoughtfulness of his work, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Like, he'll do a big movie, but then he'll do something, you know, like, he was so amazing in Training Day, but then he'll do, like, Chet Baker, and it's like, that was incredible performance.
No, he's definitely come into his own in the last few years, particularly.
For sure.
Very passionate and very kind of fearless about
but
what he's
going to
do.
But not in a wanky, actor-y, you know, craving the wrong things way, you know?
So do you hang out with actors or do you hang out with other people?
I don't really. Not really. I mean, I know them because how could I not? I think... I don't know. I hang out with all sorts of people. I tend
normal
to be
humans.
Friends with a lot of writers. You know?
So you just have to get them to write something great for you.
Exactly.
You get the Allison Janney thing.
Yes.
So is that something you'll do, writing?
I'm a bit lazy.
So you have to be pushed to do it?
I think I have pushed to do it, yeah.
But you would like to?
I sure would. I mean, it's all very well to sit here and talk about writing. It's that discipline. It's something that it's a very different discipline. You know, I can see something and know where it's going wrong and help fix.
Mm-hmm.
But that idea of sitting with a blank page is terrifying, you know?
Yes, it should be.
Yeah, right?
Too many people think they can do it.
I know.
But then
so maybe I should just
Well, you never know until you get in and go do it.
I
that's
think
the thing.
Of the way, I mean, I think of my work as sort of slightly co-writing, you know?
Mm-hmm. That's how you like to work with directors and on projects.
I do, yeah. You know, I know I'm not sitting down there like breaking story, but you know, you do have a lot of input. You know, if you're sort of in the right groove.
So if you were if you were not going to be a celebrity anymore, and you were going to have a different life, that'd be okay with you. It sounds like.
Yeah.
Not that you aspire to it, but that you'd find something else you'd like to do.
I can't think of anything nicer than being a sort of, you know. Woman wearing a cardigan with a cat on her lap, drinking her tea, and
it's
getting
so specific
up and writing
an image.
Like poking around in the garden and then going back and writing a few, like Virginia Woolf.
Mm. Very romantic notion.
Very romantic notion.
Of course, she did commit suicide,
I know, but
that's a downside of it.
I know.
But you will not be going there, I don't think.
Who knows?
I don't know.
I mean,
you
don't
seem
know.
Like the kind of person who really would ever be that person.
I don't know if any. I don't know if you can tell about people.
Well, that's
their
true.
Darkest sort of. I don't think that while there are people who love me around, I would do something like that. It's just too mean.
There seems to me like if you were ever in a. See, I'm completely. It's absurd that I'm even saying any of this. I'm going to withdraw. Like, I'm sitting here, like, I'm going to tell you what you... Okay,
well, go on.
Silliness.
I like it.
No, I just think if you were, like, you know, getting the stones on the side of the river...
Yes.
...to go walk in...
Yeah.
...that you would say...
What am I doing?
What the fuck am I doing? I'm going to do something fun. I'm going to go do something creative. I'm going to do something...
It's hard when you're in the dark spiral...
Yeah, that's
...when the
true.
Blanket of, you know, doom comes over you. But, I mean, I think that's part of, like... Knowing that part of yourself is good as an actor, you know, it's good to know all these things that, you know, and so maybe watch out for them a bit, you know.
So it sounds like anything could happen.
Anything could happen.
The next Paula Malcomson interview could be her, you know, her Tony winning.
Dr. Malcomson.
Dr. Malcomson. A are. You could be a Nobel laureate. You, hey, you know, if Trump thinks he can win the appeal, the whatever, the Nobel Prize, you could win the Nobel Prize.
He probably will.
I have no question about it, because, you know, he deserves it. He
sure does.
He talks to short guys, so, and plays with giant envelopes and lies a lot.
I can't even, because it's too... This is. I may just throw. Imagine if I just threw myself off the balcony.
It's horrifying on a daily basis.
Yeah.
The only good thing about it is I've come to believe it will end at some point.
I know. I just hope we get like good art or something out of it. But I don't think that's true either, because everyone's stifled.
Well, I think by the time it's over, we're going to be so sick of it.
We're so tired. Everyone's so busy shouting at each other, they're wasting all their energy.
Yeah.
You know. And then, and that news cycle. You know, that sort of like we're eating the fucking news, even though it's not news. It's all just shit.
I keep on thinking the next president's going to be the most boring man in the history of mankind.
It tends to go that way, doesn't it?
Very boring. Because who wants this every day? Even people who like him have to be sick of it at some point.
Oh, no, they love it. They're all fired up.
Oh, God.
They're so pleased.
See, I theorize that people... I'm not going to say that on camera. But my theory is that people who are into Trump are people who have been abused. And that it's a form of abuse that they actually attract. They see in him that he is an abuser... And they see it, and they're drawn to it as a form of, like, power. And it's like that somehow that thing, that women who like bad boy kind of thing or whatever, where they're drawn to it in a way they don't really even know.
I think just human nature is so complicated.
Yeah.
You know?
But,
I see the point, like you're saying, someone that comes in and takes charge and is full of their own fucking...
No matter what it is, whether it's true or it's not,
yes,
it's just the fact that they're willing to take control is...
I think this. We've been working up to this for a long time, though.
Yeah.
You know, our society's been working towards this. You know, there are many others to blame, not just this one guy.
Well, there was a brilliant article in The New Yorker a couple of years ago that I have to find one of these days because I've been mentioning it, but where they said the only way Trump can happen in a society, something like him, is when the society's actually doing really well.
Mm-hmm.
And that we're then our guard is down, and we believe that we are, you know, we've gotten past the point where we have to defend ourselves against the bad guy, and that we can somehow, like, nothing is satisfactory because we're too comfortable. Mm-hmm. So everything, we're always just a little pissed off about everything and willing to open to that idea.
We're too comfortable in that. Why are we too comfortable? The planet's fucked.
But we don't know that. Nobody knows that. You know what I mean? Like, you still go to the grocery store.
I know.
There's,
I know.
Particularly in America, of all places.
Yeah, we're like,
we are so overstuffed as a nation.
Stuffed.
I mean, we have everything all the time. We can, you know, it's just about how many channels. Oh my God, it paid $120 for DirecTV instead of $30 for streaming on whatever. It's like,
I know.
our rage is petty.
They'll throw me out of the country if I say too much.
No. We love you in this country.
I know, but they can still chuck me right out.
That's well.
Boot me out. Boot me out. Like, get the fuck out and don't come back.
They haven't knocked on your door and said, you're the one?
Nope. But, you do.
But we're moving our way towards that right
now. But you worry about these things in the middle of the night when you're going like, well, I've got, you know, what would I do with the dogs? How would I, what would I do?
When you look at families being separated the way they've been separated and... parents being picked up on the street who were not actually criminals and being deported away from their kids. It's not what America should be. It's not what any place should really be. It's kind of like we can afford to be nicer to each other.
I'd like that.
Yeah.
I think that'd be great.
Well,
in general. In the whole fucking good spirit of like, we've got so much, let's give more.
But if Ray Donovan were nicer to himself, then there'd be no show and we wouldn't be having this conversation.
It's not his fault. Poor Ray.
Well, I don't know that it's anybody. That's the thing. Nobody's fault. That's a tricky part.
That's
ultimately
the tricky part.
People who behave badly were abused in some way that made them, created them. And so the sympathy level is there. But on the other hand, you've got to get over it.
I know. I guess that's the thing of, I don't know. Compassion, self-compassion. Don't know.
Okay. No Virginia Woolf for you.
No Virginia Woolf.
We've now have decided.
Stones.
This is not an option. No stones in the side of the thing. No fake nose like Nicole Kidman.
She was so good in
She's
that.
She's really good in it, and the obsession with that nose pissed me off.
I know.
Every time they mentioned it.
I didn't even see the nose. She was so brilliant.
Yeah. She's a wonderful,
she's
wonderful
a
actor.
Wonderful actor.
Yeah. She grew into it. She was like at first.
So good.
The Claire Lewicki days were not so pretty, but she learned to act.
I think she always had something really...
Well, potent. She was magical on camera,
yes.
But she really learned, I think she learned to act like, you know, 5 years into her marriage with Mr. Cruz.
Right.
And that was something, like, she'd like worked and figured it out.
Yeah.
But she was always, even in the, like, the early movies and the Australian stuff and whatever, you could see there was something. But, yeah, she really became an actor. It's always nice when that happens.
Yeah. I mean, that one would hope if you're on set long enough, you'll get good at it, you know?
But some people just don't have that thing.
Oh, God, no, they just don't.
They don't have the gear.
They just don't. They don't have it.
Yeah.
You know?
It's always fun when Hollywood tries to make them stars for years on end.
It's on. Because
I've seen that.
Yes. I have to sit and watch it.
You watch it really close. No, it's really,
really
weird.
Yeah, it's really weird.
And that is not just females. It is men as well, for sure. Where it's like, this guy's going to be a movie star. We're going to do it because he's so good looking and he's, you know, not so much.
Yeah, I know. I can see when it... I used to see it with sort of these bad boy types. There was something kind of alluring about that kind of... But, you know, that's not even true nowadays. They're just like, they've got muscles or something.
Yeah. Well, it's funny because it's a show like Ray Donovan. One of the things that's, I think, draws people to it is that it's an ensemble of actors, all of whom can really act.
Really,
they're like actors. They're not.
That's right. And the thing about
half-asses.
Those actors, Liev, John, Dash, Eddie, me, Karis, Deb, everybody is such a smart actor. Is the other thing, you know? There's not one that's like. You know, because sometimes you get actors who are, they're just really good, but they're not that smart.
Right.
There's a funny thing. This is a smart bunch, you know. Yeah. I'd like to see Eddie have his own show. I'd like to see Dash have his own show.
I saw Eddie in something recently where it's really...
Yeah, Deadpool.
Yeah, in the Deadpool movie, it was like...
I know.
So out of left field, which is great.
It's so joyful what he's doing. You know, it's so... He's having the time of his life.
Watching Eddie chew scenery is a joyous thing.
He's wonderful.
He doesn't get to do it. Actually, we just saw Jurassic World 2, whatever it is, and saw it's... I'm forgetting his name. The small guy with the blonde hair, the British actor...
Toby Jones. Yes.
And he's kind of like this kind of big hammy role in this movie. The Trump hair.
Just love
and it's
that
just
stuff.
Fun to watch.
It's just like, it's just, oh, yeah. I loved it. I loved seeing Eddie in that.
Yeah.
You also love seeing it because, you know, like, there's a massive paycheck on the other end of that and he deserves it so fully, you know.
I like actors to get paid.
Yeah.
Everybody should get paid. Yeah. God bless America.
Indeed.
And Ireland, for that matter. Thank you so much for
your
time.
Thank you.
I appreciate it.
Yes.
A pleasure.
It was such a pleasure. It was fun. Easy to talk to you.
We try to make it easy.